Introduction. Hi. I think everyone almost knows me. I'm Jennifer Lagrotte. I have a doctorate in marriage and family therapy, and I got my master's in marriage and family therapy, both at Nova. I'm licensed in marriage and family therapy and mental health counseling. So when you look at my name, there's just a lot of initials behind it. I could have more initials, but there's only so many initials that you need. My philosophy on therapy, which a lot of people really like, is I stay positive. It's kind of my philosophy on life too. I try to stay as positive as possible. I've really been involved in this new method, which a lot of this stuff is going to come from tonight, the Gottman method. I've done level one and level two training, and I'm scheduled for level three in Tampa. And a lot of the things that we've been incorporating and I've been working with my clients on is the Gottman method. So solution focused and Gottman is pretty much who I am. So Courtney, when we talked about this, and we thought, well, what would be the best topic to talk about? And how to have a relationship with small kids. And I'm a mom. I have two girls. I have a three-year-old and a five-year-old, and they're with me all the time. I work part-time, but I consider myself a full-time mom, even though I work part-time, and it's a challenge. So what do you do? Well, first you have your husband do the slides and not his own work. Okay, I can't read that. So I'm going to talk like this, okay? There's only going to be one slide about yourself, a lot of slides about the relationship, and one slide about parenting. And I put this first for a major reason, because you're yourself first. You're not a wife, you're not a mother, you're not a sister, you're not anything if you're not yourself. If you're not grounded and you're not who you are supposed to be, you're not anybody. So you need to decide how you want to be in a relationship and how you want to be a parent. And that sounds pretty vague, but if you really think about it and you talk to your... Is everyone married? Yeah. Everyone's married. Okay, so I'm not going to say partner. I'm going to say husband. Yeah. That works. Because I never want to assume anything in this world. So talk to your partner. Make sure you feel the same way about parenting and a relationship. And, you know, we hear this stuff all the time, but I'm going to say it and you can blame me. You need to find an hour a week. I don't care if it's 10 minutes a day. I don't care if it's 1 hour. You need to find some time for yourself. Whether you lock your kids in your room or you sit them in front of the TV and you veg out. I mean, I was in my car today reading the Pottery Barn catalog. You need to find time for yourself. It's vital to who you are, whether it's going to the gym and not even exercising and just leaving your kids in kid care. It's at the Y. Everybody does it. I mean, it's not that big of a place, but they love it there. Like the guilt that goes along with thinking that you're not doing the best for your child when you take something away from yourself, it needs to leave tonight, because if you don't do for yourself, you cannot do for your kids. Know your boundaries. Does anybody know their boundaries? Does anybody know when it's time to take a mommy or wife time out? Do you guys know when to do that and when it's important?
You can do that better later, first year or no.
Okay. What's harder, to take a mommy time out or take a wife time out?
Really? I was going to say wife, because for mommy time out, I mean, I can put the kids in front of the TV and, okay, that's my time. I'll sit there. But a wife time out, I just feel guilty, or I feel like then it's going to feel like I don't know, it's going to be annoying with me if I just need time.
For yourself?
I mean, well, no, if I need a timeout at the moment. You know what I mean? Not if I just want to, like, go.
Right. You know, sometimes it could be both, because you can give your kids to your husband and then he can be with the kids and you can have a mommy and a kid and a wife time out at the same time. And right.
Once the husband's a lot, they probably don't go to bed.
There's women, absolutely.
They don't see husbands a lot, that they probably want to spend the time maybe with the husband. So I guess, but I think, yes, everybody needs a time for themselves,
It's when I'm talking about a timeout, it's when you're over your limit. When you just can't function anymore and you're not thinking clearly and you back out of the driveway and you back into someone's car because you're overloaded, that's when it's time to take a timeout.
I found the rest of people that after my first
year. Yeah.
So
or
once a month massage.
Or when you crack your phone.
Every day.
Right. Like, when your kids are really small and you're giving everything, it's much harder to do. You know, that's where the connectiveness of relationship comes in, because you need to rely on your husband and understand that he loves your kids just as much as you do, and even if he doesn't do it the same way that you do it, they're gonna survive. So, and it's letting go of the control of your way is the only way, because it doesn't work. It, you know, and husbands, they try to go along with it, but they, especially in this area, husbands have opinions. They don't just blindly go along, or they go and they find another avenue to relieve their stress because they don't feel that they can come home and talk to you. So when your stress level gets to the point where you even see your husband and you just think burning negative thoughts, that's the time to take a time out. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about, oh, well, you know, my kid, you know, ruined my couch or something. I mean, that's the start of it, but it's a build up. So we're clear what I mean. I mean, I'm a realistic person. I'm not telling you to, you know, go to the spa every day and be nice. But like I said, like, you know, the YMCA where your kids can go, you know, I mean, or, you know, something, just something. Well, that's one thing that we're going to talk about, roles. Is everybody in here a stay-at-home mom? Mostly? I mean, everyone has other things. So what's our definition of a stay-at-home mom? What's the job hours? What do we think?
24/7?
But I'm asking, like, what is your expectation for you and you and your husband? Like, what do you consider your hours for being a stay-at-home mom? Because that's your job. It's your job. You don't get a raise. You don't get anything for it. But that's your job. So have you and your husband ever sat down and said, all right, well, these are my hours for being a stay-at-home mom? And that's one thing that we're gonna talk about, because it's not a never-ending 24/7 job. There is a time where you and your husband parent together, at least.
Right.
At least 50-50. You know, it would be nice if when your husband's home, it would be at least 70-30. But to start out, it needs to be 50-50. And there needs to be defined roles on who does what, because I don't know about you guys. Everything okay?
Oh, yeah.
The flood, you have, my husband does the water remediation and you just go. Right,
well, you can, you can watch it.
Yeah.
Do you want to grab food?
No, it's okay.
Sorry.
Sorry,
bye. When you're saying 50-50 though, like in some households, like my household, that's not possible. So, I don't know if that's what you're asking. I'm curious too, like what.
No, but when the father's home, I think she's saying. Like when your husband's home. At your home, it should be both.
Well, okay, so let me go through these. Let me go through these a little bit, because there are certain things that need to be put in place. And one thing I want everyone in this room to get out of their heads is, when my husband is home, he needs to help out. Because that is way too vague for a man's brain. They need a sign. He has to deal with this all the time. He knows there's nothing I'm saying right now that's foreign to him. He's brainwashed at this point. But just telling someone, well, I need you to cook dinner tonight, or I need you to do this, I need you to do that. We actually came up with a marriage contract, and which was one thing that I'm going to talk to everyone about. And there needs to be defined roles in your house. And what we do is, he is responsible for the kitchen. And that was even too vague. Because I'm like, well, does that include meals? Does that include cleaning up the kitchen? Does that include all day? I'm like, because it was too confusing to say, well, you're gonna do the garbage and I'm gonna do this. I'm like, I will take care of everything else. Your responsibility is the kitchen. Well, that had to be revised, because that wasn't working, because the garbage is in the kitchen. What does that mean? I'm like, these conversations need to be very specific. They need to be, well, what's your responsibility and what's your responsibility, and we need to talk about it in the beginning, at least once a week, to figure out who's going to be responsible for what. So it's not, when your husband comes home, it's, I need this, and they're like, I need 5 minutes to breathe. You're like, I've been with the kids all day. You don't get that 5 minutes. You know, there's got to be a give and take. And let me tell you something, husbands want to help. Okay? They love their kids as much as you do. A lot of times, they don't know what to do. We're home with them. We know, we can see it when the temper tantrum is starting. We can see it when thing, and it's so much easier to just deal with it ourselves. It is giving up that control and understanding that there is another way in order to make a relationship work. Now, to parent is different than making a relationship work. That's what we're focusing on, is making a relationship work. The first thing is talking. I don't care how much you think you've talked, you don't talk enough. Communication, communication, communication. I can't stress that enough. And it's not communication when you're angry. You need to communicate all the time, so everything gets out, so you don't build up the anger. And the, how do you do that? who knows their pattern of cycle where they fight? Does anyone know their pattern? Do you know your pattern? Right. Well, your roles are going to be way different than anyone else's. You can't go to your friend and say, "Hey, what's going on in your house?" That's not going to work for you. Your defined roles are going to be completely different than someone that has a husband that's home every night.
Right.
you know, so you can't base it on that. And we can talk about it and figure out something that would work for you, but you're absolutely right, that wouldn't work for you because you couldn't leave. You couldn't leave that, but you could say, well, when he is home, what is his role going to be?
My girlfriend has a pilot husband, and she told me the same thing. He's gone for 3 weeks. When he comes back, he takes care of the son, but like, baby, do the dinner, you know, I just need to relax. I work so hard for 3 weeks. And she's like a Gestapo. She's straight in line. I was like, listen, what do you think I'm doing every day? I work to take care of my son. So this is not you coming home from work to your vacation house. Like, you know, when you're home, I'm expecting. And then she said it took her a little bit, but now he's straight and he knows now, you know, to help her out. And,
right.
You know, so I'm saying is that everybody can kind of find the rules, even if someone is absent for so long. It's just going to be a little bit different.
The thing that you just said, that's the important part, is defining the roles. It's not the rules, it's the roles. Defining the roles when someone's home and when someone's away. And that's what you have to do. You're both parents, you both decided that you were gonna have these children, and you both, I'm gonna stress this 100%, you both love your children the same amount. Just because your husband's away for 2 weeks, he doesn't love your children or you any less. It just makes it a lot more complicated to figure out. But it can be figured out. Because I'm sure when he's away, things are so much easier. You know, you're on a schedule, everything is running your way, he comes home, you're expecting this.
Well, even just like if the kids get in, you know, like you said, I want to give him his chance to do things his way, but then it's like, disrupts the rhythm, and then
right.
It just makes it hard. And it's not always 2 weeks, it's just like 3 nights in a row, and then he's back. To, you know, like it's just really hard because you can't, it's never a
No, it is hard. It is hard. So how do you two deal with it?
We've been together 12 years. Like we can talk about it for a lot, but it is, I just feel like that's our cycle. It's like when he gets super busy or like it's too long or it's too many, and it's fresh. I mean, Courtney's a lot like, we'll make plans, and then I call her at 7, and he's not coming home because some bad guy went to Hialeah. So that, and it's fresh. I feel like that's what we have to keep working on is like how frustrating that is for me.
Right.
Because I really don't have a life unless he comes. I mean, like, we don't have a family here. Like, he's the only person that can leave me a lot of times, so that's hard. But I just feel like that's the cycle. It's like, when it gets really crazy, I get burned out. You know, when he's home, he's great.
It is crazy.
He's not home. It's hard.
There are two types of problems in a relationship. There's gridlock and there's perpetual. Gridlock problems is this example where you can't change it, you need to compromise it. There's no changing your situation. There's finding a new compromise. And I know you don't think that there is, but there is a compromise. Well, I'll figure it out and I'll write it down for you, okay? Okay.
I'll take that too. My husband's the exact same thing.
The pattern that I gave is it's just one I learned in school. Wife nags, husband drinks. Husband drinks, wife nags. Everybody has a fighting pattern. It's good to know your pattern in order to stop it or see when it's coming. Okay, just like you need to take some time for yourself, you need date nights. I say this all the time, and it's true. It's true. If you cannot get a babysitter, swap with a friend. Have your friend watch your kids one night, and you go out one night. If I had the time, I would set up a site for everyone to do this. But you need to go out, and if for some reason you can't go out, and I don't, going out with your kids is not the same thing. When you go out, you need to remember how to date. There's an app, 1,000, what is it? 1,000 questions. Yeah. He has it on his phone. Because we use this when we go out sometimes, because 1,000, what?
Just ask.
1,000 ways to improve your relationship. And it's either a book or an app, but it comes up with questions. And I tell couples that have just not been communicating and they fight all the time that this is a great conversation builder. Will bring up something like, if you found $100 on the sidewalk, what would you do with it? You know, and it seems trivial, but no cell phones, no talking about kids. You used to date before you had kids. You didn't always talk about kids and household stuff. But when you go out, it just seems like it's an extension of what's going on at home. If you can't do that, find things that don't involve talking, comedy clubs or movies or something that you can, or you know, music or something that you both enjoy. But if the conversations always lead back to household stuff, no, and I'm serious about the phones. If you can't not look at your phone when you're out on a date, leave it in your car and your husband too, because it's a distraction. It's a really bad distraction, and leave it in the car. It just that little part could improve your relationship so much if you're not like checking your phone or putting your date on, okay, well now we're doing this and now we're doing that. Now I'm like, we just talk and enjoy each other for an hour. If you only have an hour a week, enjoy it.
Bothering him enough that he took it so that I was not allowed to use my phone.
You do. I'm sure it's.
Oh, then he went to the bathroom to steal it back. but clearly it was enough for him to tell me that he's going to take it away because he wanted that time just us without this.
Oh, I get mad when he's on my phone and we're watching movies. I don't think he's getting the movie and I'm watching it on the phone. He's not allowed to be on the phone.
So, honey, can you? Thank you.
We make a point to go sit in our formal living room, which we never use. So it's like not a comfortable place for us. It's not that it's not comfortable, but it's not the living room where we're always there. Or we take the baby monitor out back or go in the hot tub. We do something that's just for the two of us. No kids, no distractions. If we can't get out.
Right. And you need to do something. And it's good if you both plan it, you know, and that could be a part of your talking is who's going to plan what and 1 week, and you can come up with topics. You could both read a book. It doesn't have to be the same book and you can talk about it, or you can, you know, come up with a current event and talk about that, you know, make an effort and get dressed up, you know, make an effort. It's not, you know, you don't show up if you're staying at home in your, you know, pajamas and like, hey, date night. No. Make an effort. Okay, I've talked about these till I'm blue in my face, and I wrote a blog about it. Rituals. Okay, this is where the connection comes in. If you don't do any other ones, then you do this. Have a ritual in the morning. Say hello. Find out. You can, one thing that we do or I suggest is find one thing that's going to happen in your day. Tell him one thing, he tells you one thing. Okay, something in the morning, acknowledgement when you come home. Okay, a kiss, a hug, a handshake. Just joking. Acknowledgement. Okay, and I know that it's busy, you're crazy, kids are all over the place. Acknowledge your husband when he comes home. He needs that. It's important. We don't think he needs it. You're already annoyed with him because he's late or something along those lines. It's not his fault. Okay? He needs to feel welcome in the home, that this is a place where he wants to come to. I get it. I completely get it. like I said, I wrote a blog about it. It was on my Facebook page. You guys can look. But one thing also, 10 minutes a day, you talk. Again, no cell phones, no anything. You talk for 10 minutes, he talks about it for 10 minutes, and that's how you don't let things build up. You talk every day. Okay, and one person should not be bringing the thing up. And it should be when the kids go to bed. One of my things about the kids is they need to go to bed early. Okay, my kids are in bed by 7. We have dinner after they go to bed. That's our time.
But what about, like, if your husband gets home a little later and it's like you want your child and the dad to have a little time together? You know what I mean? Like, otherwise they're never going to know each other.
What time does your husband get home?
It's different each day, but sometimes he won't come home until 7:38. And I don't want to put her down until, like, 9:30 because I want him to have daddy.
There needs to be a compromise. First of all, how old are your children?
Just 2.
Right. She shouldn't be staying up till 9 o'clock. Okay.
I think
she shouldn't. She needs to be. And honestly, you're setting up sleeping patterns for the rest of their lives. If you have bad sleeping patterns or you can't go to bed so late, talk to your parents about it. Find out what they did when you were young. Kids need, when she starts going to school, she needs to be in bed earlier. And I understand your point. But you're changing your child's natural sleep patterns for your husband. And that's not good for either of them. And what do we think about that? What, does anyone have an opinion about it?
My first kid with Jack, I used to do, I had the same predicament, his ability to get home so late, and it didn't work. Like it just didn't work. Like you can't keep him up. So now, I guess like our agreement is he gets up with the kids every morning. Like it doesn't matter if he gets home at 4 a.m. He gets up with the kids and he spends the morning with them because that might be the only time he sees them that day.
One ritual that we set up in our family, which has become really important to us, we talk about our day. Everyone talks about it's really called highs and lows. You talk about your favorite part of the day, you talk about your worst part of the day. We added silly and gross because we have small kids and they love it. But like you said, perfect example. That's done in a small window of time. Everybody gets it. Everybody finds out about everybody's day in a very small amount of time. And they always know daddy's gonna say, oh, my best part of the day was coming home. They're like, daddy. You know, he says pretty much the same thing every day. But everybody gets, and it helps him because he only gets to spend maybe 10 minutes with them before they go to bed, and he gets to know about their entire day. So that's one thing that we did to help, and I think it has helped, and it has helped develop a relationship. Another thing that was important is he was working a job that took him away on the weekends. we decided as a family that wasn't good for our family, and that he wasn't seeing the kids at all. And they did not have a relationship with him. So it was more important for him to give up that job than to not spend time with the kids. And so we made a decision and a big sort of sacrifice in our lives so he could be more involved in our family. And you got to do that kind of stuff. So, and we don't want to do it to sacrifice what's important for our children. We need to always remember that family time is just as important as everything else. And you got to push it. I push it all the time. I mean, family time is very important to us, and we have great family time when we're together. We have family days, and we have a great time. But you need to promote it. You know, I mean,
family bedtime stories. Everybody climbs in my oldest's bed, and the four of us get in, and I'll read a book, and my husband will read a book, and sometimes that is the only time that they get with him.
Right.
If he's,
And it's not quantity, it's quality. You know, if your children have only 5 minutes to spend with one of you a day, make it worth it and make it a family time. Are we all okay with that one? And we're gone. We're what? Okay, we'll do the. But it just stopped working. Okay, but.
Run our battery or not? Just have them plugged in. So I'm wondering, is this outlet, did the outlet not work? Was it running on battery and then it died?
Okay. Does anybody have a family budget? You do? Okay, you guys talk about money? But I mean, do you have a family budget?
Yes.
Okay. Does everyone have a family budget? Do you all know the money coming in and the money going out? Basically, everybody needs a budget, and everything needs to be budgeted, and money needs to be talked about. We're not living in the age where, you know, oh, something happens. Well, I didn't know. You know, we all need to know. And money and sex are two things that are just not talked about in our family. And if you don't have a budget, have one. And I mean budget for everything. Like, one thing I really forgot to budget for was birthday parties. And this past year, I was like, whoops, we need to budget for birthday parties. So we have everything in there. We have our going out expenses. We have our, you know, birthday parties. We have our car expenses, everything. And it's something that you kind of need to go over every once in a while and be realistic about it, even if you're spending more money than you're making right now, because these kids are so darn expensive, and preschool is so expensive, but it's temporary. It's temporary, but talking about money is helpful because it's a stressful topic. So make a budget, okay? When you talk, when you do this 10-minute talk, you talk about emotions. You don't problem solve. It's too easy to say, well, we have a plumbing problem. What are we going to do to fix it? Okay. When I say talk about emotions, the best way to do that is, I feel this is what's going on with me. And if your husband doesn't understand or know how to talk about emotions, the best, easiest trick is to have him repeat everything you say. And then you do the same thing with him. And you start off that way, like you're having a conversation. And so, okay, so I heard you say, this is not going well, and I would like to work on this, and this is how I'm feeling. Was that okay? And that is the easiest way to start having someone understand that they don't need to solve your problems, they just need to listen. So in that 10 minutes that you talk every day, it needs to be about emotions, not about problem solving. Does everyone understand what I mean about that? Okay. We talked about this. You need to have known shared responsibilities in the house. Obviously, everyone's house is different. You need to talk about it, and it needs to be known, and it needs to be revised. If your husband is responsible for taking out the garbage and waking up with the kids, and for some reason that's not going the way you want to, you need to talk about it and say, hey honey, we talked about this, what's going on, how can we fix it, before you get angry. Okay, that's the trick. If you're talking all the time, you're going to be able to have these conversations before the yelling starts. And that's what you want, because all they hear is blah, 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 blah. They don't hear you. So you need to say it in a nice, honey, I love you. This isn't working. What's going on? Okay, and I yell, I scream, I get angry. I'm not saying this is perfection, but if you put some little things in place, like a talking every day and having rituals and acknowledging each other and going out on dates and really connecting, these are just little things that actually really help you stay connected. And that's the point with the craziness of life, is just stay connected. Remember, you're in a relationship before you had children, okay? They don't run your lives. I know you think that they do, but they really don't. They can learn to wait while you're on the phone. They can learn to say, excuse me, if you're having an adult conversation. They can learn all these things. I know I've taught my children how to do it, okay? If your husband is talking to you about something serious and your child comes and you immediately go to your child, it puts them off, okay? You need to learn when your husband really has needs and when he needs to be listened to, because at the time when you really need something from him, he's not gonna want to do it because you're over here all the time. You need to be connected with him, and you need to remember that your children don't always come first. Is that a hard concept for some of you?
I think the only hard part about that is, so let's say he comes home from work and I know he's tired and he's hungry, and they need to be done with the day, like they need to be gone. So I know this, and he now has guilt because he hasn't spent time with them, blah, blah, blah. So he comes home, and I'm like, Daddy, Mommy are talking, you guys need to go to bed, this is done, this is quiet time, and then he will not go with what I just said, because he, it's okay, and then wrestle, and then
right.
Run, and scream, and I'm like, I'm trying to do this for us, like, you need to be with me, but then I understand he wants to play with it. So it's a lot of not follow through, and so the kids,
you know, and this is where the communication comes in, because all you have to say is, honey, I love you. I really want to listen to you. This is driving me crazy. Like, if you're okay with it, let me take care of this, and then we can go back to doing what we need to do. But if you just walk off right in the middle of them, you know, telling you something important that happened during the day, they're not going to want to talk to you when you get back. So you need to communicate and let them know your feelings. That's where the emotion part comes in. And let them know that it's too much for you. And that's the reality of it. You know, husbands want your attention, they want your attention, and your kids want your attention, That's when the mommy and wife break come in, but also it's you learning who needs it more, but your husband deserves the communication part. because what they have to say is important, and what your children need sometimes can wait. So, and once you develop the kind of relationship that you want with your husband, he can help you with that, because he can decide when it's okay to pull you away from your kids. And that's a nice thing, actually. Right, honey? I've said this before. Who is okay with their kids sleeping in bed with them?
Okay, anybody in here? Sleeping situation is so effed up. It's bananas. You guys would die if you guys watched my situation.
My theory on kids sleeping in bed with you is it can't just be one person that's okay with it. Both of you need to be okay with it. And I'm actually talking about it and saying, tell me how you feel about this. Because a lot of times you say, all right, well, we're going to have a baby, and the baby's going to sleep in our bedroom. And, like, there's no asking. And I just dealt with this. I have a client who got tired of her son coming into the bedroom and put it upon herself to fix the situation. And she had to realize through me that she didn't even ask her husband for help, but got mad at him because he wasn't helping. And she just expected him to get up. And I'm like, well, when, because we talked about it, I'm like, when did you talk to him about it and ask him his involvement? There was nothing along those lines. She just expected him to go along with what she says because she's a stay-at-home mom, and that's just the way it is. And these men, people don't work that way. They don't work on commands like that. They need to be asked. They need to be told. If you're having a young baby and you want your baby to sleep in the bedroom with you, make sure it's okay with your husband. If you want your child to sleep with you at night, make sure it's a joint decision. That's the only part that I'm talking about. Make sure it's a joint decision and it's not just you that's doing it. We're clear on that? Okay. I said this all the time. Your partner, your husband loves your child just as much as you do. There's nothing that he or she, well, no she's in here. There's nothing that he does that doesn't mean that he doesn't love your children. They're his children. And he's not around as much. You are. He loves them. He does not do things the way you do them. That doesn't make it wrong. And to you, in your eyes, you could take it and you could fix it like that. You could, if there's a temper tantrum starting and they're doing something, you can fix it. It takes so much control to not get involved and let them deal with it, because they do deal with it in their own way. It's just not your way. You're with your partner because they're different. You did not marry yourself. But along the way, you start to really resent and not like those differences. That's who you married. You're not spending your entire marriage and your entire life trying to change them into you. Okay, they're different. That's why you guys argue, and that's why you fell in love with them to begin with, because of those differences. And so many couples get into these problems because they just want it their way. And they can't see it. You both are right. If you don't take anything else from this, remember that. You both are right. You just need to figure out compromises and figure out a system that works for you. Okay. Thank you. I talked a little bit about a marriage contract. I'm not going to go into too much about that, but it's really just your needs, goals, and desires. And his, and you need to make sure that they're the same, and revise it every once in a while. We did ours, and we need to go over it and make sure that it's the same. But sometimes you lose track of where you are, And it's good to talk about these things, whether it's writing it down. Some people are better at writing than they are at talking. So it might be better to write things down than to talk. That's why I said you leave the talking to 10 minutes. It doesn't turn into a monologue. 10 minutes each day. Talk about sex. Who talks about sex in their house? You do. Does anyone like have a sex plan and they have sex on a regular basis? Maybe not. Maybe not the pregnant one and the new mom. Okay, we'll leave you two out. Do we have sex in our houses? Yeah. You know, I just read a book, and it was a good book, and it said, you know, you think about it this way. When you plan a date, you plan what to wear, you plan where to go, you plan what to do, you plan who you're going to go with. Why is it so wrong to plan sex? People have this, and it's movies and these stereotypes that it's supposed to be like this spontaneous, you know, animal attraction that you continuously have, and that's just not. I mean, we're busy. We're you know, we don't have time. We have kids. We're tired. Sex needs to happen, and it needs to be talked about, and it does help your relationship. Okay, so if it's not part of your lives, minus you two get a break right now. Well, maybe not you, because maybe you want that baby to come out, so.
You know, the doctor feels his head, and I told my husband, he's like, ew. Like, I promise you, you're not going to
just okay. But sex should be part of your relationship, and it should be talked about just as easily as money is. Okay? Okay, now we can talk about the kids. I put them at the very last because they're the least important part. The kids are okay. You all are here because you're good parents. It's so hard to be a bad parent. You know, we all make mistakes, but we read in the news about bad parents. There's nobody in this room that's a bad parent. If you spend time to work on your relationship, it's not going to make you a bad parent. It's going to make you a better parent, especially if you're having more sex. I already talked about the sleeping. If your schedule doesn't allow it, you need to make time for you and your husband. You know, if you want to keep your kids up, you still need to schedule out some time during the day for you and your husband to connect. It needs to happen on a daily basis. For us, it's the easiest thing. And this is one thing that I am so strict about. We don't keep our kids up for any reason. Like, not for a party, not for this and that. They go to bed, they know their bedtime. They go to bed, that's it, see you in the morning. And I know, as a person, we talked about what my time is. 7 in the morning till 7 in the night, I give them everything. After that, I'm done. That's it. No more. Time for my relationship. It's time for me. I get it. I get my relationship and me time during the day, but my kids get me for 12 hours, and that's more than enough, in my opinion. I give them a lot. They don't need more than 12 hours from me. This is a basic one. If you disagree, don't do it in front of your kids. If you're going to reprimand your husband or talk down to him, if you do it, apologize. Let your kids know that it's not okay, and daddy does things different. Daddy loves you. Okay? Make up for it. We all do it. It happens. You're angry. If you do it, apologize for it. Your kids need to know that mommy's not just the boss, daddy is the boss too. Okay, and it's way too easy for us to fall into that role that mommy's the boss and daddy doesn't need to be listened to. because the way you're talking, if that happens in your house, it's because the way you're talking to your husband, and you're saying, no, don't do it that way, do it this way. Don't try and catch yourself. If you do that a lot, your kids pick up on it. They're smart. They're so smart. They know everything. Try not to do it, okay? Don't let your children run your life. You as a couple need to help each other out with this. You know, this is where the relationship really comes in, because if your husband feels needy, it's because he's not getting you enough. And he needs you. He needs that relationship. And if your kids are getting to be too much, then you need to give something to your husband. That's part of a relationship. You know, and if you can't give anything to your husband, you need to tell him. You're like, you know what, it was a crappy day, and I'm exhausted, and I love you, and I don't have anything to give you tonight. Tell him. Use those words. Communicate. Okay, nobody's a mind reader. Nobody understands that. You know what bad day you had. Your friends know what bad day you had. But your husband, he really doesn't know. Say it exactly like that. Give him an acknowledgement, give him a kiss, but don't patronize him either, you know. But he knows when you have a bad day. But it's not his fault. It's not his fault that he's working and you're at home with the kids. And you can't blame him for that. When you blame him for that and you start getting angry at him for the role that we have chosen, then there's problems. Because there's nothing he can do about it. He's like, well, why isn't she happy? This is what she wants. I'm working really hard so she could stay at home with the kids, and all she does is yell at me when I get home. It makes no sense. Like, that's how their brain, they're like, and they just want to work more because they're like, all right, well, if I make more money, then maybe she'll be happier. And no, that's not what you want. You want the connection. You want the this, you want that. But if you're not talking, you don't know that. So they do have a side, and they do have a valid point. You just need to find out what it is. And the idea that men can't talk, you've never been in therapy with one. Men love therapy. Let me tell you something. I've had couples come in and they're like, oh, he won't say anything to you. Blah, 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 blah. And men love to be listened to by a woman because their wives don't listen to them. And so I tell them they're right. I tell them they're valid. I tell them they have a point. They open up. The insight that I have heard from men is overwhelming. Much more than women. Because they're given an opportunity to talk. And it's just the way you say it. That's it. Parenting is you either learn it from a book, you learn it from where you came from. You're going to disagree, you're going to have different parenting styles. You need to come up with compromises that work. If you didn't talk about your major disagreements on parenting styles before you had children, if your children are young now, you need to figure it out. And I'm talking about like homeschooling versus public education. If you're different religions, what religion you're going to raise them. There's numerous things that while they're still young, you can still figure this stuff out. But as you get older, a lot of people before they have kids, they're like, oh, we'll just figure it out. You just don't. It doesn't get any better over time. You just don't want it. You just never wanted to deal with it in the beginning. So you just put it aside. So deal with your differences and come up with a compromise before the kids get to. How old is our oldest? Does anyone have any, like, over five? No, so they're all pretty young still. Okay, so this is the time to work on the relationship and figure it out. If you're ever at a point where your husband is not the first person you want to call when you have news, that's when you know there's a problem. Okay, if you want to call your mom, you want to call your friend, you even want to tell the dog, but if you get this impression, not my dogs, but if you get this impression that, oh, he won't care, or oh, he won't listen, or he's too busy, or something, there's something wrong, and you need to address it. So that I tell everybody that's a clear sign. Okay. Remember, you're doing a great job, and your kids love you unconditionally, no matter how much you screw up. But your relationship, it's a different story. You know, it's not based on unconditional love. It's if there's years of resentment and years of things being built up, we talk about in the Gottman method the four horsemen. They're the force signals, things that are in relationships that are really bad. Anger, regret, when you zone out or when you go away. There's lots of them that are signs. And there's ways to change that. One little thing that you can do, notice on a daily basis, is they're called bids. And anytime you're in a relationship, there's a bid. Let's say, like, if I'm talking to you and I turn to you and I say, hi, how are you? And you're on your phone and you ignore me, that's a missed bid. Okay? And you need to have more positive bids than missed bids. Okay? If your husband is reaching for you and you're doing something else, acknowledge the missed bid and give him something back. Okay, if you have an established relationship and you're ignoring your husband for a little while, it will be okay. But if you're ignoring him for too long, there's going to be problems. And this isn't really about the parenting part, because the parenting part is a whole different ball game. Like, I'm not going to go into the, you know, about putting your kids to bed, but we will go into the idea of roles in if your husband is away for long periods of time, because that's complicated. It is. And the only way to really solve that is both of you understand that that's what you chose. I mean, you knew that going in. And you knew it was going to be, did you know it was be that hard?
My father's in the military, so I grew up in a similar situation. But yeah, I mean, it fluctuates. You know, you have protections and then the case builds and then it's on. So, I mean, it's different being the mom and not the daughter, but
right.
I mean, sometimes it's hard with others. I guess I get jealous sometimes just with other friends. You know, they start cooking dinner to their husband's come home. Like, all these little things that make life so much easier.
Right.
But
so how do you stay connected? What do you do?
I mean, some of the stuff that you talked about, like, we talk every day no matter where he is. And
okay.
Like,
do you FaceTime?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
the kids see him.
Wi-Fi, yeah, you can FaceTime, which helps a lot. He does, like, 6-week assignments and stuff away. And, but like you said, like, sometimes I'll call him, and I need to talk to him. So, like, the kids got hurt, or I accidentally share it. You know, you don't want someone to protect your call.
Right.
And so I'll text him, like, no, please call now. And unless he's, like, doing something undercover, he will call. And, like, that's what we had to talk about, because if you keep rejecting me, you know,
right.
I mean, if you're at work, like, you're never here, so I need to talk to you sometimes. So, I mean, it's just, like you said, like, I'm fully have to keep talking.
Right.
But it is, like, just listening, I realize, like, how many more challenges we just
do. Is, Is he really rejecting you, or is he cannot? He just
no,
can't I mean, talk.
He can't talk. Like,
okay, but you but you feel
you
right, right. You feel rejected.
I feel rejected.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
College, so I mean, it's not new. It's just it changed a lot once we had kids. Like before, it didn't matter as much because I've always been pretty independent, and we had our own lives. You know, like we were together, but like if he had to work all the time, it didn't bother me. It's so much harder when we have kids.
Right.
So you need to be partners. You know, you need help. So, and our kids are my oldest is 4. So, but then you know, we moved here right after he was born. Our families aren't here, so just.
In your perfect world, what would you want?
A full-time babysitter. Like, honestly, no. Just because, like, sometimes, like you said, like, to take that break. I mean, like, last week at the Y, I went almost 2 hours every day, and I worked out for an hour, and then I sat in the lobby for an hour, and I
that helps.
Phone calls I had to do or whatever, you know, like, did stuff online because you just can't do that with two small kids.
How old are they?
4 and 2.
Okay, so your 4-year-old's going to go to VPK?
Yes.
Okay.
And he was in school last year.
Okay.
But he also has some...
Bless you.
He has an IP and some special learning difficulties, which is another challenge. You know, so just... so yeah, he was in school, and he will be next year. So,
right.
Yeah, I have a... But my 2-year-old is with me all the time.
You know, I made the choice, my 5-year-old wanted to go only to school till 12, and I knew it was going to be a hard year. But I figured that it was more important to be with her because next year in kindergarten, she's not going to get the choice to come home for lunch. And I didn't even really realize how hard it was until it was all over. I'm like, it was hard, you know, but I made that choice. You know, I made that choice to for my kids. He's like, do whatever you want. Whatever you want to do. I mean, he's very, very supportive that way. But I felt it was important. And, you know, and that's always something to remember is that we make these choices for ourselves. And then sometimes, a lot of times we take them out on them because we, you know, it was hard for me. And it's very hard for you. But it will get easier when the kids get older and they're in school more. And then it won't be as hard. But as far as getting your husband a role in the kids' lives, that's something that you two need to work on. And figuring out a time that he needs to give you some time. He needs to give them some time. Something on a continual basis, and he needs to do it, even if it's hard. These choices aren't always easy, but when we talk about family, so, you know, he's not going to want to hear it, or, you know, work comes first, and no, work doesn't always come first. Family sometimes comes first, so you two need to figure out his role in the family and figure out how he can play a role, because he doesn't have a role right now, does he?
I mean, when he's home, that's just the thing. I guess it's just more frustrating when it's like not
control,
you know,
confusing.
Like, and just like like you said, he can't not have a job, but he gets a call and he has to go later, he has to work. So like,
right.
And he's out of my control, but at the same time, like, then we're both working overtime, because then I'm, you know, continuing with the kids. Like, I don't have 7 to 7. So it's hard. I mean, there are considering other options, like moving, and which could help change his role a little bit. But then you have other stressors, you know, like move again, you lose your base support that I've built here, and starting over. But I mean, it'll only get easier as the kids get older. It's just this hard.
Right, but as far as like setting up a schedule or a pattern for you two right now, you need to have something in place, because the kid's schedule will get better, but his schedule won't get any better. I mean, everyone's husbands work a lot, right? I mean, if you're on living on one income, that one person needs to work a lot, and that means that you're working a lot as well. But you can't fight over that. You're both working a lot. You know, and that's the important thing to remember. You're both doing it.
Yeah, but they sometimes don't understand that. Like, no. My husband didn't understand the first year because I was working always full-time, and then unfortunately, I become a full-time mom. So I was with baby all day. He was coming home in the afternoon, and, you know, he had those couple times in the beginning. He said, what did you do? All your job is just taking care of our son. I mean, I was ready to put the bucket of hot water in his head, and I almost did once or twice. But then, you know, there was a couple of situations when he ended up staying. Couple hours straight that I almost purposely didn't come back. So he realized what it is. Now, this is just happened at the beginning. But they don't understand. Many men don't understand what it takes.
If my husband ever said that to me, I'd be like, bye. See ya tomorrow.
Oh.
The best way to explain that to them is to leave, and get them to completely 100% understand. Even if you sit that kid in front of a TV for an entire day, it's exhausting.
Yes, with the baby, yeah.
Exactly.
My husband. It's and.
You know,
But the
difference is it's emotional work. Because before I had children, I never worried about anything. And all of a sudden it's not so much physical, but it's the emotional, it's the worrying, it's the this and that, and it's hard to explain that part of it, because at least for me, that's what gets me exhausted at the end of the day. It's the emotional part. It's the don't fall, you know, don't do this, you know, don't do this. Did you eat? Did you do? You know, it's all that stuff that gets me. But everybody needs to leave their kids alone with their husbands. If anyone is afraid to do that, you just need to leave the house and don't come back. I'm serious. It gets, trust me, it gets easier. Right? It's uncomfortable at first. You want to come right home. And then after that, you're like, all right, I'm going for the weekend. Bye. You know, your kids love you, whether you're there or whether you're not there. They love you. It's so much easier to deal with the kids and their unconditional love than dealing with the husbands and ignoring them, because their needs are. Do you think that husbands' needs are unconditional? Do they give unconditional love?
I try to explain it to my husband, like, because he leaves and he's gone for a long time. And I say, I don't know how to explain it to you, but like emotionally, I would never be able to do what you do, which is good that you're able to do it. But I tell him, you're able to leave and like you just disconnect. Like you're physically, when you're here, you're physical with them. You take them out, you run, you do. And then when you're gone and you go into a hotel and you're there for whatever alone, you just disconnect. Where if I was going to a hotel for 2 days, I'd probably be like, let's FaceTime all the time. What are they doing? Are they okay? Did they eat? Did they go to the bathroom? Da 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 da. Are they healthy? Like, I'm always like, you know, emotionally connected to them. How are they? Are they feeling okay? Were they sad? Did they miss me? And him, it's like, well, he knows they're okay with me, so he doesn't worry about that.
What was his answer?
He says yes. It's true. He says, yeah, I can disconnect.
Which is probably better. Yeah, you know, because then they can focus on work and what they're doing, and then all of them worry, and they know that the babies have a mom that's everything to them, so that's why they have the peace. When we are away, we always want to check, because we think that no one does the same job as well as we do.
Yeah.
So the same thing, every time even I go out with my girlfriend, I'm on my phone making sure my husband, how he's giving advice, I'm not going to come, sometimes I'm even, I told him by 9 o'clock he needs to go sleep, but my course, my husband never does because he wants to hang out with him. And I'm, many times I want to grab the phone and say, why he's not sleeping yet? Yeah. My guy's like, leave it. This is his time. And, you know, just happens once in a while. Let him just be. The same thing, I want to control it when he does because I don't like it, but it would be still eventually.
Well, you said it, and I'm not even sure you heard it. You said he trusts you, and that's how he can do it.
Yeah.
You know, and even if you hired a babysitter, he trusts your opinion, and that's the connection right there.
Yeah.
And is that enough? I don't know. You don't want him to be worried about the kids all day because he needs to focus on his job. And just like you can't be worried about his job all day because you need to be focused on the kids because that's your job. You know, I asked that question. My opinion on a stay-at-home mom role is working hours. And then on weekends and evenings, if your husband is home, that's 50-50. You know, and if you can't do that, if it's too hard right now where your kids always come to you, always come to you, always come to you because they're used to you, you need to leave and let him build up his role. Because honestly, if you take a step back, they will start coming to him. It takes work though. And they love it. They love being dad. They love the hugs and the kisses and all that stuff. They love it. You know.
Where resentment comes in, and I don't know if your husbands do this, but and if they do, please tell me. But I feel like he trusts me with the kids. Like obviously he knows I'm gonna make sure that they're not gonna die and that they're gonna be healthy and all that good stuff. But I feel like there's like no the respect aspect of me being the mother kind of fades away, and I think that's where we have problems where. He'll
give an example.
He'll say things like, not all the time, but when he gets frustrated or we're upset with each other, whatever, he'll say things like, oh, I know they eat candy all day and they watch TV all day. And I'm like, really? Because that would be awesome. I would love to give him tons of candy and just sit him in front of the TV. Or, you know, like, you don't give him enough vegetables.
Wait. There, I'm sure there was at least 5 conversations before that comment came up.
I'm sure.
But comments like that don't just come up. There's things that have been built up in order for that to happen.
He gets frustrated because the little one doesn't eat. He likes snacks. He doesn't like to eat food. And so he thinks that because he doesn't eat, he eats snacks all day. And that's all he eats all day. And that's like always a topic of conversation. And I'm like, I don't know what you want me to do. I can't make him eat. But then getting that information into his brain doesn't...
Right. You know, I'm a big believer in 2 things: pick your battles and whatever works. Like I don't over parent at all. You know, if we're not in our house right now, my little stubborn little girl wanted to wear high heels. Did I want her to wear them? No. Did I put them on her? Yes. 5 minutes later, did she take them off? Yes. Because I knew she wouldn't actually be comfortable in them. But if I went with the battle with that, it would have been a battle. And I didn't care enough. You know, and you really have to pick your battles with the kids and the husbands. And figure out what's important. And me, like I'm really good at knowing, like I said, because I have that 12-hour window, so I know how much energy I have to give. And that's it. I don't give out anymore. But there was conversations that happened before he just said that, because nobody just says that. And just like your husband too, like they don't just come out and say it, but that's what we harp on. There's a lot of things that happen before that. And that's why if you're talking and communicating and really understanding each other, and I'm sure like the little things you said, he respects you. You two just need to figure it out how he can let you know that better. After you have the baby and you get back to sleep deprived, that's another thing. I don't recommend starting things when you're pregnant or if you're sick, like that's another thing. My woman that did the sleep thing, we started this whole like sleep thing and then she got sick and she kept on doing it. And I'm like if you're sick or if something's wrong or there's something that happens, the kids will be okay, the husband will be okay. Take care of yourself, please. Don't think that, you know, they need to eat like their 5 pieces of broccoli and or, you know, life is not that important. Okay? Don't start anything until your baby's sleeping through the night. Okay?
2 years. I know.
Yeah, well that's a whole nother topic. Which we don't have time to get into right now, Courtney. Does anyone else have any questions or anything?
Is there such a thing as too much communication? Because I feel like sometimes
there is job. There is. See, you miss it. 10 minutes a day. That's okay, I'm not telling you to put a stopwatch, okay? That's a kind of a roundabout. Yes, there is too much communication.
And then today, actually, finally, like, I realized I do it too, but it's not verbal. At home, I text him all day. And I told him, I'm going to try not to do that. And it's hard because every little thought I have, like, oh my gosh, my mom made that comment, and I pick up my phone to tell him.
Right.
And he's like, I'm actually not bothered by it because I like hear from you, like you send pictures and you know, but let me do it too. And my version is when I come home, I have to tell you my entire day.
Right.
And I'm just like, so.
Yeah, there is too much. And but see, the thing is that it has to be more frequent in order for the communication to be lost. And if it's every day for a little bit, then it doesn't have to be like blabbing all the time and then being like, oh, she's still talking, you know. So and that hurts. That hurts when you want to talk and your partner just doesn't want to listen to you, and that opens up just a whole nother argument. So you need to keep it short and you need to get everything out that needs to get out instead of it being built up into resentment where it just all comes out as anger. And one thing that I also talked about is that you need to talk from emotions and not problem solve. And you need to listen. One person talks, the other person repeats back what they say, and then the other person talks and repeats back what they say until you both learn how to do it. But that's what I suggest you do if you don't know how, because men especially, okay, well you're tired, all right, let me hire a babysitter for an afternoon so you can sleep. You know, that's not what you want to hear, but men just want to solve the problem. You know, and that doesn't help with the relationship, you know. And men need to be taught a little bit that problem solving isn't always the right thing to do. Listening, you can solve your own problems. You're a very functional person. You know, if you want to hire a babysitter for the afternoon, you'll do it. You want your husband to listen to you and understand your feelings, and that's what you want. You know, so they need to understand this concept, and you can't go home tonight and say, well, we're going to talk about feelings. Not going to work. It's building up to it. It's learning how to do it, and he's pretty good at it now. But it's taken a lot of work. And let me tell you something. There are not a lot of good therapists out there. And we talked about that. I mean, we went to therapy, and I was like, you know what, honey? I'm like, we just have to figure this out because it's unfortunate, but there's not a lot of good therapists out there. So pick your therapist wisely.
Do you have strategy? I feel like my husband
does
the same thing, too. And I feel like it's been most stressful having a child who's
special needs because sometimes I just need to vent or like express my fears or like what I'm, you know, what I'm going through because it's hard. And he's like, well, let's do that. You know, like, what, you know, he just wants to fix it or fix the problem, you know, and it's right. Just so, I just need you to hear me. I need you to let me talk this out and I need you to tell me, listen to all the things I'm doing to try to help him and give me feedback, but I don't, we're not going to fix, like, so how, I mean, you say don't just go home and talk about emotions, but like, how do you
like I said, the first example is just have him repeat back what you say. Okay, and then him talk and you repeat back what he says. I feel that we're not connected and that we need help. I feel that we're not connected and we need help. You know, I feel that all you do is try to solve my problems and I want you to listen. And if they have a problem with that, tough. Okay, because there's a communication problem and it needs to be fixed. And they're in this relationship too. And there are some things that need to be done that they need to put effort into. But continuing to do your same pattern as you talk and saying, I need this, I need this, and he's like, well, what do you want me to fix? It's not gonna work, so he needs to try it. And if that doesn't work, then you need to write it down. And he needs to write you back and try it that way. But there's gotta be a point where he starts talking about emotions or he talks to somebody and learns how to talk emotions. Because, I mean, just last night, I had a session with the woman asked the man something, the man answered, she didn't hear his answer. Because she's not used to him talking. I had to point out that he answered the question, but he also asked her a question also. And so, but if I wasn't there, that would have been a completely missed bid because he answered her question, but she didn't hear his answer. And so communication is hard to do, especially if you're not a communicator. And that's why I'm saying this listening, talking, it's speaker, listener thing is just a way to start building and hearing what you're saying. So try it, and if it doesn't work, you let me know, and I'll give you something else, okay? Go ahead, you were gonna say something?
No, speaker-listener. Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah, and you know what? If your husband's like, oh, this is just another thing, don't let them get away with it. Because this is how you feel, and they don't want to keep on hearing you complain about the same things. They have to give. You know, this, it's a relationship. They have to be part of it. You know, this whole big thing about Ben and Jen and if marriage was work, and some people call it work and some people call it compromise. I don't care what you call it, as long as you're doing it together. Like, I read that whole article where they considered it wasn't work, but all they did was use the word compromise where someone else used the word work. It's just a word, you know, whether you're deciding what you want to watch on TV. If you want to watch, he wants to watch something and you want to watch something else, what do? Do you go to separate rooms or do you compromise? You know, and there's so many choices that you have to make in your relationship. You know, right now where we're staying, it would be so much easier for us to sleep separately. But we're choosing to sleep together and both not get a good night's sleep because our lives are so crazy right now that's the only time that we have to connect. And we're both sacrificing a good night's sleep to be closer to each other, because sometimes you have to make that compromise, and you just have to do it. And you're like, oh, there used to be this concept called quid pro quo. Well, they still is. You do something and I do something. I'm very against that because it becomes a competition. I mow the lawn, so you have to, you know, wash my car, or I did this, so you have to do that. It shouldn't be a competition. But bring up the emotion talk and see how it goes, and let me know. And if that doesn't work, then I'll come up with something else. Okay. Right, and it might be that the compromise is to only work on things when he's home, and understand that when he's at work, and it's not personal. And understand that that's your life, and understand that it's going to get better too. And then when he's home, then you have roles, then you have communication. But when he's away, he does the best he can, and you don't give him a hard time about that. And that might have to be enough for right now. But you both don't need to be upset about something that you can't change. You need to find something good in it. Right? Okay. Have we talked enough?
Thank you.
Yes. Okay. If anyone has any questions later or whatever. He's not listening to us. Yeah, exactly. He's zoned out. He's doing his work. Okay. I'm sorry.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're so welcome. You're so welcome. Yeah, it was a crazy week, and I'm glad that I got to do this. Going out of town on Sunday, so this was it. Now we can go. But if anyone has any follow up questions or anything, you can take my card. Oh, such a sweetie.
Do you have any advice on how to switch from being a mom to a wife when your children are still awake?
You need, we have our kids understand that on the weekends, him and I, we have nap time.
I can't.
You can't.
I can't emotionally cut off when my kid, I can hear them running around the house, they're banging on the door, I cannot switch that. And that has actually been, like, not that it's a big problem, that's been one of our biggest problems.
Could you?
My husband is like, who cares? They're not coming in. Well, who cares? I do.
Okay, well, we tried after our little thing. So Dave came in, I was like, you locked the door, right? He's like, yeah. He locked the front door so the kids couldn't escape. Like, a
few seconds later,
you know,
right now.
Kate, but what about
the front door?
what about a movie or something on TVs? So they're quiet.
It's not even just the quiet thing. It's like, me anticipating their needs. Like, I know a lot of other moms who, their husbands are away all the time. You're just used to being on 24/7. I can't even sleep when my husband's gone because I'm the sole provider. I have to keep them safe. They're on the complete opposite
side
of the house.
And he's gone a lot, right?
A lot. Okay. He's gone for more than half the year.
Okay.
I can't emotionally flip that switch so quickly that, you know,
does he ask you to? Does he feel neglected?
I wouldn't say neglected because there's plenty of other opportunities after the kids go to bed. But, you know, spur of the moment kind of stuff, and I always shoot him down. And it's, you know, I think he's becoming a little bit resentful that I emotionally can't hold that switch when for him it's just like, who cares?
Well, okay, so I think that you might need to go about it in a different way and get your kids to understand that mommy and daddy need their alone time, and that it needs to be.
I don't think it's really the kids. It's just me.
Getting that sexy.
Yeah, I can't.
Well, okay, so are you specifically talking about having sex?
Yes.
Okay.
We can talk.
talk and all that kind of stuff when the kids are awake. That's fine. I'm
do okay. They do they have a playroom? But you said they're on the opposite side of the house.
I mean, we don't even necessarily have to hear them, but in my head, I'm thinking, well, what are they doing now? I bet they're playing in the toilet. The sink's running. They're going to let the dogs out. They're going to do this. But, you know, whatever it is.
That has nothing to do with your kids.
No, it's
you.
Emotional.
Yeah, it's you.
Yeah.
It's you. It's not the kids.
No, it's not.
So how come you can't focus on your husband?
I guess it's maybe because I choose.
You choose
my
not.
Role before my wife role.
Are you still attracted to him?
Oh yeah, sex is never an issue.
Okay.
That's not the issue at all.
It's
just sex when the kids are awake.
Could you ask him to help you with this and force the issue and help you get over it?
I guess.
Because he needs, it sounds like he kind of needs to force you to step out of the mom role.
Mm-hmm.
You need his help. You need him to say, it's time, the kids are okay. And it's kind of getting used to it. I know.
So like,
I never
happens that easier will become kind of thing.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You need his help. I mean, if you're attracted to him and it's something that you want to do.
I just don't want him to become resentful that it.
Okay. Okay. You need to talk to him, and you need to find out if it bothers him.
I know it does.
Okay. And it bothers you too.
It bothers me that it bothers them.
It needs to bother you too in order to want to change it. Because in order to change it, it means that you're stepping out of the mom role and you're going into the wife role.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to do that. That's what we're talking. This is a perfect example because that's kind of what we're dealing with here. You need to get out of the mom role.
Right.
He needs to force that issue on you until you get used to it.
Okay.
How does he do that? Like, how does she tell him, force me, like grab me and force me, like grab me and force me?
Yeah. You actually do.
Maybe got a couple of drinks.
Right.
You know, and honestly, I mean, and it has to be where the kids are safe and doing an activity where they're engaged and they're not. I mean, you know, if he's just gonna, it has to be set up where they're okay and they're not.
Yeah, if I throw them in front of the TV, they'll sit there for as long as I let them.
Right.
Put a snack there. Mm-hmm. They're good for like.
Right, but he needs to understand that it's not just you're going to say, well, I need you to be strong about this, and then the first time he does it and you resist it because the kids aren't set up the way that you want them to be set up, you need to say, okay, I'm going to do this, but the kids need to be in a safe setup environment. It can't just be that they're playing, okay, let's go. You know, so if you're going to make him responsible for it, he needs to know the guidelines and the parameters of what you're comfortable with.
Okay.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Okay. The worst for me was letting my kids cry at night, and he would take the monitor from rip it out of my hands, like it would but that's their role. And he has taken me from the kids so many times that I've gotten used to it now.
Okay.
That I've been able to step out of the mom role.
I mean, I have set up really good limitations with my children when my husband's gone. We eat dinner at 5:30, they're in bed by 6. They don't have to go to sleep, but they have to be in their room, mommy done. Like when my husband's home, they can stay up until 7, whatever, that's fine. But 6 o'clock is my cutoff when I'm by myself. So, I mean, I'm not so much having the problem that, like, I can't really push control to other people. It's just...
But after the kids are in bed, do you have enough energy to give to your husband?
Yeah.
Yeah, you do. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, because you know, everyone's a little different. I mean, with how much energy.
I have a question about that, like, different than you, but like same topic of, like, I work during the day, and so it's just a little bit different. But then he gets home at 7:30, puts the dishes down. I do both the girls' basketball, the girls' sleep. Then it's 8:30 by the time he gets
tired.
Home. I have a 7-month-old. I'm freaking exhausted. I'm right. Just tired. And, like, we're going away this week. I can't wait. And I go, what are you most excited for? And he said, I'm excited for you to wake up rested. You know, and so he gets it, but at the same time, I didn't know, how do you, like, snap yourself out of that at 8 when I'm so tired?
I know, it's hard, and I think the important part, and I've kind of learned this, is that you do need to find times when the kids are awake. You can't leave it all to after they go to bed.
Does it get better after the kids are sleeping, though? Than after your kids are sleeping through the night? Are you sleeping?
Oh, yeah. I wouldn't suggest anything until your kids are sleeping through the night.
Okay.
You know, I mean, that's tough. You know, there's...
But they really do, you know, really, like, I put them to bed. I feel like our time together on the couch is a lot better. I wake up tired, but, like, in better mood. I don't know, things are easier than when you're just completely and totally exhausted and your emotions take over because your hormones are off.
Yeah, there's an emotional exhaustion when your kids aren't sleeping through the night and you're working and everything, and but there still needs to be that little itty bit of communication that I love you, I'm exhausted, let's try again tomorrow. They can't be completely ignored because they're doing their big work too.
I don't ignore him, I ignore myself. I think that's where it comes from.
That's where it is. Right. Where are you going?
We're going to Barbados.
Oh my gosh. Nice. Are the kids going? No. Oh, even better.
We need it.
Oh.
It'll be great.
Perfect. I'm so happy.
Because it's the baby's 7 months, so I'm late now, and I just needed that little, we needed us time.
Right. We're going to Vail on Sunday. Our kids are coming with us, but they're signed up for camp, which I have to, like, I basically had to, like, give them their left leg. I mean, the things that they wanted for camp. But they're in camp 3 days, and we're so excited. We really are. And, you know, I mean, taking a vacation is another thing. I didn't even bring that up. But it is important to get away. And, you know, if you're fortunate enough to be able to do it, it's nice.
I believe 2 vacations. One with kids, one without.
That's the ideal.
No. Yes, I know.
It's a business trip when you go away with your children. There's no vacation about it. It's just work somewhere else.
And I even tried to bring our mother-in-law, which I love, just because where I was advised, at least I get some rest. No, it didn't work because I want to still be with my kid no matter what. I feel guilty that I'm not there in the ocean. So I decided it's better have 3 days with just husband and 1 vacation with my
husband. Absolutely.
Ideal,
there's two kinds of vacations.
No, absolutely. You know, I am the Miss Laid Back. Like, my kids, if they want to eat chocolate for breakfast on vacation, they can, as long as they stay happy. That is my only rule. I'm like, I just want to have a good time. Whatever. I mean, I load them up with whatever, and I just want everyone to have peace and have a good time. And you know what? When you're a mom and you go on vacation with your kids, if you have a good time, it's great. It's not expected, but it's great. But the more you go, and the same thing with going out to eat with them. That's a whole nother. Like I said, that's a whole nother topic. But as far as making time during the day, Kate, I would absolutely ask your husband to make that his priority. And
I mean, he has gone about or more than half a year. So, I mean, sometimes I do only see him on weekends. So, I mean, 2 days a week is not really up to our
schedule,
I guess.
So how do you two stay connected when he's gone?
We talk to each other all the time.
Right.
He goes, he's back at his hotel at night, so after the kids are about to walk, call each other.
Right, but do you guys flirt or anything while he's away? No.
I read that it's very important to send one compliment if it's possible a day. Like, I know it's like some people are like, what? We don't do that. Like, I started trying it, and he started doing it back, and it just brings that excitement again, because you know, you don't do that.
You need it.
So I was like, okay, you know, let's try it. And then, you know, I did it, and then he started doing it, and Mark is doing it now, but I remember when, like, we started doing it, and it was a really good effect.
I know. I mean, you had a relationship before you had children, and
you know, it helped me because I feel like I'm in the same boat in that arena as well. And my husband's not like a forceful guy. If I told him you need to like force the issue, he'd be like, "Yeah, you're crazy," right now. Because it's not in his nature. It's not like he's very to a point where it's kind of like, no, like you probably need to grab me because you know he's just very polite. So, but anyways, I can't shut it off. I just can't shut it off. I just can't. But I feel like what something that helped me was if he ever wants something during the day, like he, like spontaneous, he feels like there's time, but I don't think there's time because the kids are awake. I decided in my own brain that during those times that he, which are rare, not really often, but when he does, I won't say no, but I'll not ask that, so I'll like, be like, can I touch you or can I do this? And then it'll be quicker. I mean, I know that, right? And so I don't let him down and he's like, oh, yeah, okay, yeah, that's exciting. Like, it's something different. And so, I don't know, that was something I was able to do.
You give him something.
I gave him something.
That's all they want.
And he wasn't offended. Like, he was like, really? And so now I do it. If he asks, I'll be like, yeah, let's go to the bathroom.
I just carry like this would happen all the time. Yeah, you know, like, you've been figuring it out, you know, like. You're gonna say a little bit.
Yeah.
All right.
And that's the reason why I said that was my compromise because I know he won't always ask for it. So I was like,
right. He's mine. Yeah. Oh, mine has no problem being forceful. He's like, oh, you're not gonna say no anymore? Oh. Okay.
But you know what, for husbands that are away all the time, flirting or doing something while they're away might not be the worst thing for your relationship.
Yeah.
Just saying. Yeah. Right? Okay.
I was just curious, as a therapist, are there some topics where you're like, oh, I love to talk about sex, and other topics you're like, oh, money, that's boring.
Are you talking about personally?
Personally, yeah. Just what interests you, like, do you have hot topics that you just are your passions?
Oh, in my own relationship or in therapy? Well, you know what, as a therapist, I enjoy working with couples. And so whatever they bring up is what I talk about. I mean, if you're coming to therapy for couples therapy, it's usually about communication or somebody cheats or somebody's thinking about cheating or communication. It really boils down to communication. So I loved talking about that, but there's not really a topic.
Are there some couples where you're like, you're really intrigued by their story and other couples you're like,
yeah. Are you asking, there haven't been many people that I have seen recently that I don't like. I'm pretty good at finding things that I like about everybody. My real frustration comes in when I want to help someone more than they want to help themselves, or they know they have a problem, but because it gets brought up in therapy, they stop coming because they don't want to deal with it. And it's so apparent to me, and of course I want to help everyone and fix everybody, and you know, in any job that you have, you want to do well. Like, I just saw a couple that he cheated on her with texting a year ago, and they're just coming in now, and it was so hard for her to make the appointment, and he was late, and she was like, should I still come? I'm like, so hard for you to make this call. And now I'm like, well, I hope they come back, because we brought up, like, the first session is always pretty hard. Like, there's sometimes things come up that make people not want to come back, because there's, it brings up a lot of stuff. And not everyone can deal with stuff. You know, they're stuffers. You know, but the stuffers are the ones that get divorced because they just don't talk about anything, and then eventually they just move so far away that there's no coming back. So I enjoy working with couples. I don't work with kids anymore. I used to, but I don't deal with them enough. But you know what? It's funny because I always thought I would just be a stay-at-home mom. I mean, I had my degree before I had my girls, but I always thought that I'd be a stay-at-home mom, and then I started working again. And to me, like, that's my stress relief. I love working, and it's weird because I never really, I didn't think that I would. I thought that I would just be a stay-at-home mom, and but I do struggle. I struggle with, and I have a perfect opportunity because I can always be there when my kids need me, and I'm still a stay-at-home mom most of the time. But I get this, I'm like, I want to work more, I want to do this, I want to do that, and then they're like, well, mommy, so I struggle with it.
No, how old do you think is a good age to go back
it's,
to work?
It's almost... Does anyone have a good answer for that? I mean, some people go back, like, right away.
It depends if you want to go full-time or part-time.
Right. Like, it's harder. It's harder part-time.
But not like a...
Harder part-time?
Oh, yeah. Because you're trying to balance both.
It's, but then when you do full-time, then you feel so guilty that you never would get.
Well, okay, and this is what I talked to about someone yesterday. I mean, it makes no bearing on anyone's life whether you're a stay-at-home mom or full-time worker. You know, I mean, people that stay at home that think that they're doing that because that's better for their children, but then they really want to work. You know, it leads to conflicts and being upset. You have to figure out what works for you, whether it's part-time or full-time or no time at all. I mean, I don't know any mom around here that really doesn't do something. I mean, everyone eventually gets into something because we're all, like, highly active people, you know, and our brains can't just, you know, fall into mush. But when I started working again, and I started having these conversations with people, and I started going to these conferences, and I was like, oh, okay, this is good. This is
nice. And your marriage, it got better, probably.
I don't know, honey. did our marriage get better? Maybe. Maybe. Our marriage has gotten better with the stuff that I've been working on, this Gottman stuff. And I made him read all the books, and so he knows. And I do these relationship assessments, which are great. And I made him do one, but it pretty much just tells, like, everything about your relationship. And
where do you get the assessment?
It's through me. Like, I send it to your email. And you both do it, and then you get the results. But it's a great tool to have. And did our relationship get better after I started working?
Oh, look at him.
How many questions was on that test though? It was
480. Oh my gosh, stop. Are you serious?
Oh no, I'm not kidding. It was 400 and something questions on that.
It was, yeah, it takes a good, like, hour and a half. But you know what, you can save it and go back. It didn't take me that long. I did have to remind him to do it after. I kindly remind him to do it. but it's a pretty good way to figure out where your relationship is and what's going on with it. So
it's definitely something to talk about though before you go back to work, because Dave and I, we've always communicated things fine. The hardest time we had was when right after I had Tyler, I decided to go back to teaching ballet, which is an evening job, and it's always in the evenings and weekends. And I left him, and Tyler, who's like a couple months old, he's a new dad, he worked all day, he has to come home and take this like baby, he has no idea what to do with. And he was so resentful, because he didn't know what to do, he was exhausted, the baby was screaming, he wasn't me, he didn't know what to do, but I wanted that time, and I felt like, and looking back on it, I would have done something differently. But even now, I'm having to be more mindful of, I love going to do it. I get paid pennies. You know, it's not, I'm not working for the money. Okay, I work to teach 4 or 5 hours a week.
Right.
But, especially, okay, they just have to forget it. I'm not going to lose the money. But for me, even if it's like stressful to try to get everything done with the kids, once I'm there,
right.
Even though I'm dealing with other kids, it's different. It's a passion. I enjoy it. But at the same time, I can't do it every night because Dave doesn't want to do it every night. He doesn't want to have the burden of coming home from work or leaving the sitter or my mom to then bathe both of them, put them both to bed, you know, on his own. That's not what he signed up for, and he made it very clear. Like, he would love for me to just be stay-at-home mom 100% all the time. He knows I enjoy doing that, so he's happy to have me do it, but it's like one night a week is enough for him. Mm-hmm. And so it's having to figure out those things. Because me, for a while, like, I wanted to open a ballet studio. I really did. Would love to do it. Might still happen. But we've come to the realization that it would take away a lot of family time.
Right.
Being a weekend job. As much as I think if I own it, I can schedule things. When you own something, I had to manage the nutcracker this year, and that I realized how much time it takes. So I think it's hard wanting, we have our own wants as far as work and wanting to be our own person and have our own feelings, but we also made the choice to have a kid and have a family and have a husband. So you have, there's a give and take. And I do regret when Tyler was, and we were not really discussing it with Dave, what the impact was going to be for him, for me coming right. back. I just wanted to do it, and I didn't. It's having a baby too, it's like, we'll just, you know, balance him, fire something, but it seemed easy to me, was not easy for him. And it was like one of the hardest times we had in our relationship, because he was just so resentful over the fact that I didn't listen to what he had to say about it. I just,
like, you just did
already in it, so you need to deal with it.
Right. Well, I know this is hard for us to realize, but our kids aren't always going to want us around all the time, and that's the time when you do it, you know, like, they're going to grow up, and you know, for me, like, I know that the older they get, the more I'll work, and the more I'll do, so, you know, and I'm doing enough right now. Like, I have a hard limit. I don't take on more clients than I can handle, you know, and I have boundaries, and I don't work, you know, on the weekends, and I try to always be home for bedtime, you know, but they understand now, they get it, they get mommy works, and they get what mommy does, and you know, it's good for them. I think it is good for them to understand that mommy is a job, and, you know, we explain it all the time that mommy's job is you, but mommy also has a job, and daddy has this job that he's not home because he's making money for us, and so we can go spend it on clothes and whatnot. But
the other thing that I hate is, like, being a stay-at-home, like, I'm a physician assistant. I work really hard to get my degree. I have an amazing job, and I got pregnant, and I always wanted to be a stay-at-home mom. But, like, now my daughter's like, Mommy, what do you want to be when you grow up? Yeah. I have a career. Like, I was somebody. I was, you know, I had a really good job. I already am grown up, number one. Number two, I had, like,
right.
a zillion jobs already. What do you mean, what do I want to do when I grow up? It's like that, I guess for me, not working, it makes me a little bit resentful that my kids don't
Yes. Audrey's big thing is, like, every day she comes up to me and she goes, Mommy, you stay here now. I go teach ballet. I love you. You stay here.
bye. And she goes, and she goes and teaches ballet. And then she comes, I come back now. Okay, that's good.
I know, right? They do that too. They're like, we're going to go see our clients now.
Aww.
You know, let me get my appointment book and figure out when it's going to happen. And it's, they do get it. But you need to set her straight.
I did.
You know, so we go through this thing with how many brains people in our house have. And they're like, well, daddy's more brains than you because he works. I'm like, oh, no. It is hard. And I don't think you really know until they get older and you can see it, like when they're not around you all the time, and then you see who they are, and then that I think that's the only way that you can really tell. You know,
I mean, that's why I question myself, because I'm like, am I giving them the best mother because I'm home with them, or would I be the best mother if I went to work and came home? I think that's where I have to figure out my own self.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm messing them up by being here. Like, I'm really screwing them up.
You
right
need,
now.
You know what? You need, in order to be the best mom, you need to do what you are meant to do.
Yeah.
That's how you, to me, at least that's what I think, that's how you be the best mom. Like I said, like, nowhere in a million years did I really think that I would go back to work. I mean, we joke, on our first date, I said we were going to raise our kids Jewish and I was going to be a stay-at-home mom. And that was it. I mean, because I went through this, you know, lots of dating and whatnot, and I'm like, I was like so set on that. And here I am, you know, working, and I love it. Like, it just, like, yeah, like, I love it. Like, last night, like, I came out for one session, and I do. I mean, and when I see what other people don't see, and I help people, and I'm like, all right, I'm good at it. I have a purpose, you know. And
I felt so bad. My husband came home, and he was like so excited. Like, he got an award, and people were saying he's great work at work. And literally, he just came at the wrong time. And I hate the dishwasher, and the kids were going. And I'm like, that's really nice that someone tells you how wonderful you are. Nobody ever tells me how wonderful I am. I wish I got an award. And then it was like just out of nowhere. I'm like, oh, such a thing. So I got an award for Mother's Day. Like, that's
not. Oh, that's nice.
I was like, oh, my God.
Oh.
But yeah, you don't get any appreciation at home.
I know. You know, it's so like, hard.
You know, like, I mean, I'm a good mom all the time. Yeah. It's just not like, it's not the same. I don't know. I feel like it's not as valid. Like you said, if you see my students, see the process of your kids, you're with them day in, day out. Even now, just having like some reevaluations done with my son, really seeing the progress he's made and all the hard work that went into that, and giving myself like a pat on the back and being like, you survived and you did it, you know, you're Abby and you did everything because no one else, like he's great, but like, no one's here to be like, you did it, good job, you know, like, you did your, it's just hard.
There's, yeah, I don't think, like I said, I don't think, like, my goal in parenting is to have my kids know that they can tell me anything and they can call me whenever they want to. And, like, there's that bond that I'm setting up for them. And being home with them as much as I am, I know more about them than anyone else does. You know, I'm like, their teachers would tell me things, and I'm like, you see them for 3 hours a day. Like, I am with them much more than you are. You know, and I like that. I like that feeling. It's a good feeling. But it doesn't, like, reward you. It doesn't give you anything. I don't think you get that until later. You know, and you just have to kind of, like, bank on it now that... And anybody that asks if they're a good parent is a good parent because they're questioning their parenting. I always say that because it's true. I mean, I don't think there's a bad parent around that questions their parenting. So I don't know. It's all a work in progress. You know, It's just you do the best you can every day and this, you know, we had a real struggle with our morning routine. And it took a long time to get it down. And it's finally there and I can't believe it was there, and like we will fight sometimes and he's like, well, you don't give me credit for what I do, you know, things are so much better now. And he was right, you know, it's like one thing gets better and then you're like, all right, well, what about, you know, this and this. And, you know, he's gotten a lot better with communication and telling me, you know, you need to appreciate this and you need to do this. And our latest thing was that he has this way of zoning out, and he's just like the other day, he's like, well, why don't you just tell me instead of get mad at me? And I'm like, oh, I could do that. Like, oh, that would make much more sense, wouldn't it? I'm like, why in the world was I waiting?